Hello, my name is Tomasz Cietucha. I am a creative sound engineer at Zylia, and I would like to invite you to our first webinar about Zylia 6DoF technology. This will be a series of webinars. During the first one, you'll have a chance to grasp basic knowledge about our 6DoF technology. We'll show you the idea, technological background, short teasers of the system in action, and in the end, you'll see what the package contains. On next webinars, there will be a more in-depth analysis and description of the use cases of our system. These are a production of a binaural recording out of Ambisonics audio and creation of a virtual 3D scene with navigable real recorded 6DoF audio. Now I'd like to invite Tomasz Żernicki, CEO of Zylia, to tell us a few facts about our 6DoF technology.
Hello, my name is Tomasz Żernicki. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Zylia. I'm really grateful that you joined our presentation and our webinar, and I hope that it will be a fruitful discussion. And at the end of the presentation, we also have a chance to discuss the possibilities of the solutions that we have and maybe how you can use it in your workflow, how to create a content and so on. But first of all, I would like to start maybe with introduction of who are we, what we do, and actually what Zylia is. So the mission of our company is to shorten a distance between artists and the audience. So what does it mean? It means that that every day we are looking for possibilities to help both artists, content creators, musicians, and the audience to talk to each other and to join on the different performances and so on. And we believe that audio, especially 3D audio, is one of the most important medium that connects everybody with the art. And especially this is super important right now during the pandemic times, when everybody sits in home and it's not possible to participate in any live event. So maybe I'd like to also give a little bit of the background. So why 3D audio is right now important, and why the solution like this navigable audio that we will talk later, why it's important right now. So this is one of the data that you can find that at the beginning of 2020, we saw a huge increase of video streaming, music streamings, and so on. And most of the streamings was unpaid, free. And then over the year, we saw like a decrease of this streaming performances. But what had happened at the end of the year of 2020 is that we observed that there is a more and more ticketed events. So people actually pay for good content, for high quality content. And this is something that really is of interest of people, because people would like to be a part of something, of the live performance, and they are willing to pay for it. And I think this is a really good also information for content creators. And the other thing, if you also look at what had happened last year, is that at the beginning of the year, we had a huge performance of Travis Scott. It was like a virtual concert that was hosted on the Fortnite platform. And you know, just for 10 minutes, 12 million people joined this concert. So this is like huge, that this never happened before. And at the end of the year, we also start observing the events like this BTS music group from Korea, that they gather 1 million fans from almost 200 countries, and everybody pay for them for their performance live. And I think this is really amazing thing that is happening right now. And if you also like to look at other data, so you know, last year we can also observe that There's a growing interest in virtual reality, like more than 6 million consumer VR headsets were sold. So as you can see, there's more and more things that happening and are really related to recreate this live performances and being their experience. And yes, so what does it mean the virtual concert? So this is one of the key things that we like to discuss during this webinar. And this is also one of the key things that we think that, let's say, transform the whole industry, music industry, audio industry. And so, you know, let's imagine that if you listen to music like a stereo music, then you focus on the music performance. But why are you going to the live performances, to live events, concerts, and so on? Because this is something that creates unique emotions. Because if you go to this live performance, then you can hear different background noises, the acoustic of the place that you are there, the people that shouting around you. And this is something that creates really unique atmosphere. And this is something that create the emotions. And the emotions are key part of every live performance. And we believe that 3D audio is that medium that can pass the emotion from the content to the people. And that's why we think that especially 3D audio is a very important part of recreation of the emotions. So what actually is the 3D audio? Or maybe first, so let's take a glimpse of what is what does it mean to be fully immersed in audio, and what does it mean the virtual concert? So you will see that this person have VR goggles, and that person can walk around the stage and go around the violin. So please use your headphones and take a look at this performance. So as you can see, you can virtually go around the violin, and this is just amazing. And this is something that with the technology, with the solution that we provide, this navigable audio, you can do this even live. But everything is based on the Ambisonics and Ambisonics format. So we provide the Ambisonics microphones and also software that you can use to create this live events and navigable audio. But Ambisonics is just a representation of the sound. And this representation you can find, for example, in 360 videos, where you, if you rotate your head, then also you can focus on different parts of the audio from different directions. So this is an Ambisonics form that allows you to rotate the whole scene like you have in the 360 video. And so if we go to more technical details about the Ambisonic, so what Ambisonic is, so if you just take this, let's say, zero order, so this is like a single microphone, like point microphone that you can use to record your voice, for example. And this is like this microphone capture all the sound from every direction, let's say, in the same way. But then if you think that you can use, for example, cardioid shape characteristics microphones, then you can have, and you can add more and more and more and more of them, then we go to the higher orders of Ambisonics, and you can split the full space, the 3D space around you, into very small pieces. And you can, using this representation, you can, let's say, just can focus or take a sound from particular direction. So the higher the Ambisonics resolution, then there also is a higher spatial resolution and then better localization of the sound that we can hear from many different directions, not just left and right, but also sound above your head. And that we came to the navigable audio. So navigable audio is based on this, based on the principle of 6 degrees of freedom. So basically, you can immerse in the space and freely navigate in the space. So you can not only listen to the audio from many different perspectives, but you can also virtually move in the space. So you can be closer to the stage or closer to the public, and so on. And if we talk about the solution that we developed, so this is both like recording side, and you have hardware. These are the microphones. You can have this is cable solution, so you can have many of those microphones, and then you can probe the whole space. But you're on the other hand side, you also have the software, and the software is fully agnostic. So you can, as an input, you can take recording from our microphones, but also from other Ambisonics microphones, or even artificially generated sound, and then you can interpolate the sound even in between of the real position of the physical microphones. So in that sense, you can move the listener in the 3D space, even if you don't record the sound at that place. So let's go back to once again to the same example that I mentioned. So once again, let's hear what this navigable audio means. So in summary of that part, as you can see, we observe like a growing demand for this virtual concert, and in our and we believe that this 3D audio is a key component of recreation of emotions and being there experience. So from our point of view, that's why we develop this navigable audio solution. And so right now I'd like to give a voice to Tomek that will talk a little bit about the technical details. And I hope that also at the end of this seminar, we'll have a chance to during the Q&A session to discuss how to use this solution in your workflow. Thank you.
Thank you, Tomasz. You may be familiar with our first Ambisonic microphone, ZYLIA ZM-1. It is comprised of 19 microphones spread evenly on a sphere. Thus, it is capable of recording a whole sound scene around it. Afterwards, we can convert it to 16-channel third-order ambisonics. Such approach gives us audio which can be listened in 3 degrees of freedom. 3 degrees of freedom means that a listener can look around during playback. Axes of rotation are called pitch, yaw, and roll. First order ambisonics has already been implemented in, for example, YouTube and Facebook, allowing users to watch 360 movies with 360 audio. Unfortunately, first order ambisonics contains only 4 channels, so spatial resolution is not so accurate. It improves substantially in third order, as described in Franz Zotter's book Ambisonics. Here you can see a plot depicting how perceived spatial depth increases with ambisonic orders. When listening in central position, there is a significant growth in third order in comparison to the first one. You can listen to recordings in third order ambisonics on a dedicated platform, host. Okay, but we're still in the FreeDOF area. We can capture sufficient spatial information from one place on a stage, but the whole stage isn't just one point. What if we spread a few more ambisonic microphones around the place? Then we would get much more listening points around the area. And we get even more, 3 new possible ways of movement. Do you remember that the first 3 degrees of freedom were rotations around 3 axes? If we add 3 more, then we have 6 degrees of freedom. Surge, heave, and sway. These let you move forward and backward, left and right, and up and down. That is right. You can move around the recorded area. Such recording is possible with new ZYLIA microphone, ZYLIA ZM-1S. With an added extra channel and a mini jack input, simultaneous recording of multiple higher order ambisonics is possible. This extra channel lets us record a synchronization signal. which is later used in post-production to perfectly align recordings from all microphones. Speaking of which, let me show you how the recording application looks like. I just want to stress that this UI is a work in progress. Now the application works in command line. In the UI version, you can adjust the position and rotation of each microphone on a map, give them names, and set details about the recording. In the command line application, you can set the names, but there is no map. There is also another option, more traditional. You can route each microphone into your DAW that supports tracks with at least 20 channels, for example Reaper, and there run the recording. After it's done, we have to synchronize signals from all microphones. This has to be done inside the application. Thanks to the mini jack input and the additional channel, synchronization impulses can be routed simultaneously to every ZM-1S. These impulses let us align and resample the recordings to fit perfectly to each other. Okay, so we've gathered our Multipoint HOA recordings. We've synchronized them. So what's next? The next step is to load them in our 6DOF renderer. This software allows for a real-time exploration of the recorded area. We have a similar map to the one in the recording app with UI, but here is one additional thing, a listener. The positions of the microphones on this map has to correspond to their placement on the real stage. For example, compare this map with the map in the application. This was a recording of Poznan Philharmonic Orchestra that took place in August last year. This was our biggest 6DOF session yet. We have used their 30 microphones, as you can see here on a map. So let me show you how it sounds when we move around the rendered space. Please wear headphones, as this will be binaural audio. On speakers, you'll have phasing issues and you'll probably not hear the effect. We're beginning from the conductor's position. Now we can move to the strings section. Here are the violins. We can turn. We can go to the woodwinds, for example. We can hear the flutes. Now we can go to the cello section. And listen to the timpani, for example. Now we can go even to the public. Even further. But now let's get back to the stage one more time. And listen, for example, to the horns. Thank you. So as you can see, you can be in any place you want around the recorded space. We can also connect a virtual 3D space to this renderer and explore it using VR headset or a keyboard and mouse. We did an interactive demo with such controls with the Poznan Philharmonic recordings. You can download it from our website. The links will be on the chat or in the description of this webinar. Such demo can be used to create content like this. We call it a walkthrough movie. You'll see here a combination of walking among musicians on the real stage and in the virtual world. All audio was generated by our 6DOF renderer. This use case will be described in more detail on our upcoming webinar. Having our 6DOF recordings, we can do much more than this. If we want to, we could do a static mix out of them, simply by beamforming specific areas in specific microphones. We can extract the audio to create an ambisonic, binaural, or simply a stereo production. In the following example, we have prepared an ambisonic mix with instruments first beamformed, then mapped on the sphere of the microphone standing in the middle, and combined it with a 360 video. You'll hear Astor Piazzolla's Libertango, performed by students of Konin State Music School. Please wear headphones. If you want to create a binaural mix, you could also do it in a similar way. Here is an example of such production. It is a piece by Christoph Papadimitriou called Esperanza. It was recorded with 6DOF in Montreal, Canada. Also, please wear headphones. Thank you. You could also do something like this. A multi-360 cam with multiple ambisonic listening points. Here, you can listen to the concert from different perspectives. And in each, you can look around. See? You have 3 degrees of freedom in each point of view. Now we can listen to the violas. And now we're in the double bass section. Similar to the movements in our renderer, we can listen to the piece standing among different sections. But here the movements between the points are not smooth. Such approach gives a listener ability to experience the concert from different perspectives. Like in the real world, there are different seats in the public, but even more. You can stand on the stage. What else can you do with our system? Imagine streaming a concert from different perspectives, in the public and even on the stage. It is doable. Think about this video that I showed you today, the walkthrough movie. There was a classical Mozart's piece, dedicated to listen from a static perspective from the public. But what would happen if a composer knew from the beginning that a listener will have the ability to move freely around the composition? It would be not only composing time, but also in three-dimensional space. So there would be numerous ways to listen to it, not just one. The SIGZOF system is flexible when it comes to connecting controllers and sensors. For example, you could make an interactive installation with it. Let me give you yet another use case. Imagine you would record a car from outside and inside with multiple ZM-1S. Then you could easily create a faithful simulation of a pit stop or even create a virtual car showroom with original sounds of the vehicles in three dimensions. These virtual applications doesn't end here. ZYLIA SIGZOF lets you record a really accurate ambience sounds for games. With object-based approach, it is not so easy to create a true sound of a forest or some other outdoor spaces with lots of details. One last thing, why not collect a SIGZOF impulse response? Of course you can do that, and use it later to place your objects inside the recorded space. This was a brief description of ideas on how you could use our system. Now I wanted to show you what is inside the package. You'll get a couple of ZM-1S microphones, depending on how big the setup you bought is. To each microphone, there is a 1.5 meter long micro USB cable and a mini jack synchronization cable. Besides that, there is a headphone amplifier with power adapter to route the synchronization impulses to the microphones. To supply an adequate number of channels, we include a 3-way jack splitter. Last thing inside is a USB hub with power adapter. To this hub, you will connect your microphones before they are routed into the computer. Also, when recording in bigger spaces, you can buy additional 10-meter USB extenders and 10-meter mini jack extenders. That was all that I wanted to show you today. Thank you for your attention and stay tuned for our next webinars. We'll start a Q&A session in a second.
Thank you so much, Tomek, for the great presentation. And I would like to invite all of you to the Q&A session. So it's really great that so many people attend this presentation. I hope that you like it. And right now we'll try to go through each of the questions that we collected on the chat, and we'll try to answer all of the questions. Okay, so the first question is, since you are talking about binaural reproduction experience, did you think of a way to record all HRTF's function for a better ambisonics to binaural transformation? And yes, that's a very good question, and this is also something that repeats quite often in our customers' questions. And so this is something that we have on our roadmap. So maybe so we also like to have like a binaural decoder that you can use directly with our Ambisonics processing tools. So you should stay tuned, and we should have this pretty soon. Okay, so the next question is, how do you interpolate between the recorded spheres? This is also a very good question. I think this is like the most important part of the algorithm. So we already covered this topic during the presentation, but let me rephrase it. So basically, in terms of the output of the interpolation in this navigable audio of the 6 degrees of freedom algorithm, the output is ambisonics signal. So we take into account many input ambisonics. It can be recorded in our system, and then we process this in our software. And we take into account different parameters. So basically, we take into account all of the signals from all of the microphones, and then we crossfade the amplitudes depending on the distance between the listener, the position of the and the position to the closest microphone. And the next parameter that we also take into account is ambisonics order. So the bigger the distance from the microphone, then of the listener is from the microphone, then we also cut some of the order, so decrease the order of the signal that we take into consideration. And why we do this? Because this is something that we mimic our hearing aids, hearing cues. So the bigger the distance, then the lower spatial resolution we perceived. And we also the next parameter that we also take into account is the low pass filtering that also mimic a little bit how we hear. But if you like to know more about how this algorithm works in more details, then you can go to the presentation, the article that we publish on Audio Engineering Society. And I'd like to ask our support team to maybe put this article on chat, so you can download it and have more details about this. But again, this is a very good question. Thank you. Okay. Third question, what is the dynamic range of Zylia ZM-1? So the dynamic range is 140 decibels, whereas the signal-to-noise ratio is 70 decibels. And so it's pretty easy to record even like a Formula One or philharmonic orchestra. Very loud sounds, but also these microphones are used for recording ambiences. And if you want, you can take a look at our YouTube channel. Okay, Tomek, maybe the next question from Eric.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The next question is from Eric, and it's, are all the 6DoF parameters available to control in real time through OSC in Reaper? And actually, the renderer is an application which is in Max MSP, So all the controls are inside the MaximSP, but actually if you want to control it through OSC, you can do it from whatever place you want. You can control it from a phone, from Reaper, for example, or for example Unreal or Unity. So it's like anything that accepts OSC. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So maybe I just also add that if you have this OSC source, then you can stream it to our plugins. And besides the MaximSP, we also have WISE plugin. This is plugin that you can use in the like together with the Unreal or Unity engines for a game development, virtual reality. So the next question was from Jimmy. Do you have any examples of or insights on using this for live recording instead of stereo systems? So maybe Tomek, could you try to answer?
Yeah, of course. There are examples on our YouTube, which you can find some Ambisonic or binaural streams, and it of course can be used for such situations instead of a stereo system. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. It's a pity that we cannot have a direct face-to-face conversation, but we're trying to do our best. So what kind of HDRF do you use? When we work on with Ambisonics productions, so we try to use different plugins, and mainly we use the IEM plugins from Graz, University of Graz, and a group of Franz Sutter, because we think that they are really good. And as far as I know, they use the dummy head measurements. But in my opinion, what is more important than the HDRF is the equalization for the headphones, because every headphone is differ from each other a lot. And what this IEM plugin has is this equalization. So please download it and you can check it on yourself that if you change the equalization for different headphones, then also the the quality of localization will change dramatically. Yeah. So that's my answer for this. I know the question from Don Tomek. Could you try to answer?
This is actually not. What is the question? Is it or will it be possible to upload a SOFA file to use on HRTF's functions? And actually, it is on our roadmap, but it's now not possible. Mm. Okay, and the next question is, will your software create a 7.1.4 immersive audio mix that can be output directly to, for example, Atmos? And actually, our software for 6DoF is not capable now for it, for doing that, but you can output this to Ambisonics. So actually you can use later on all the software from IEM, for example, to route the signals to the 7.1.4 system.
Yeah, maybe I just add that the beauty of Ambisonics is that if you have this sound representation, then you have you are able to decode it to any surround format that you want. So you can decode it to stereo, like two channels. You can also decode it to 5.1, 7.1, 22.2, Dolby Atmos, whatever is the loudspeaker configuration. But you do only one mix, and this is really important that you do only one mix for Ambisonics. And then you just provide it to your listeners, and then they can decode to whatever surround system they have. And this is, I know, Tomek, do you agree?
Yes, definitely. It is really versatile system.
Okay, Tomek, probably next question from Jack.
Yeah. It's next question is from Jack. And is there a way of using this SIGGRAPH renderer in a game engine environment like Unity or Unreal Engine? And I think it's similar to the question which was posed later, how these SIGGRAPH audio recordings were delivered to the Unreal Engine. How did you integrate this? So I will answer to this too. And so the renderer is in MaxMSP, and everything, the interpolation and the synchronized signals and playback is in MaxMSP, and the connection to the Unity or Unreal may be done through OSC, but there is also another version of the application, which is in WYS. So we can use it in Unreal, we can use it easily with WYS to connect our VR scene and use the SIGGRAPH audio.
So the next question is, why should we care about immersive audio? Okay. Yes, this is really, really good question. And so right now, especially that during this pandemic time, so there is like a boost of all the technologies that provide this being their experience, and the immersive audio is a part of it. So basically immersive means that you can feel that you are at the place. So especially 3D audio is super important, because you not only hear sounds that from the left or the right side, but you can also hear the something that is above your head, behind you, and so on. And right now a lot of big companies they trying to provide the solutions for that. For example, in the United States, there is like a growing demand for Dolby Atmos productions. So basically this is also like immersive audio and configurations of 22 speakers for Dolby Atmos. So if you have the possibility to mix and record in Ambisonics, then you can also easily create this Dolby Atmos mixes. And I think this is very important. The other thing is streaming. So we can also see that there is a more and more streaming services that provide this immersive audio. We have like a 360 Facebook, YouTube, but there are new platforms, and this is something that is very important right now from the artistic point of view, but also from the technology point of view. Okay, so the so maybe next question. Have you thought about releasing a professional audio solution with kind of breakout XLR cable from Zylia that could be possible to connect to the studio console with other microphones like Sennheiser or Rode Ambisonics mix? This could be eliminate the necessary of omni jack cable using for device synchronization. Yeah, that's also a good question. So we don't have this XLR because, you know, the Ambisonics, our microphone, this is 19 microphone capsules. So imagine that if we will have 19 or 20 XLR cables, so it will be like a nightmare. And this is just one microphone, yeah, one microphone array. So the solution for that right now is that you can use this USB connection, or if you like to use Dante, then you can also create the use the virtual Dante card in like a Windows system, and then this computer with this microphone can connect directly to the Dante network. So then you can easily connect it to other studio equipment. But you can also on macOS, for example, you can also aggregate devices like Zylia microphone with other audio interfaces like I don't know, Focusrite or whatever, and then you can have multiple microphones, not only Ambisonics, but other connected together and synchronized. The problem, as I mentioned, with that huge volumetric audio recordings is that We had to synchronize, for example, 600 channels, but it can be even more. And this is very, very problematic. That's why we use this USB connection. But we also thinking of adding a more professional interface like Dante. Okay. Jimmy, what are the capabilities for live mixing with a single Zylia mic for things like live stream? Okay, so Tomek, maybe you can try.
I can answer that. The capabilities of using just a single mic for live streams are like you can use, for example, all the software from Zylia. Like Zylia Studio Pro to beamform specific areas and EQ them individually, but also you can use IEM plugin suite or Ambix suite, and these are like multi EQ like compressors for Ambisonics, and also in Ambix suite you have loudness. Directional loudness plugin, so you can enhance some parts of the sphere. I wanted to ask answer the next question, and it is how these 6 of audio recordings were delivered to the Unreal Engine. Okay, and this was answered a few minutes ago. So yeah, through OSC, and
okay. Okay, so the next question from Eleanor, you say that the UI time aligns all microphones channels being used. Does it also just phase polarity between all the microphones? I'm not sure if I fully understand the question, but in terms of the synchronization, so all the microphones are connected in the six degrees of freedom system. They are connected using time code, and the time code is then also used to synchronize the inputs from all of these microphones. So then if you connect like 10 of the Ambisonics microphones to a single computer, then all of the signals are perfectly synchronized. But in terms of this phase differences, So the phase difference is really important in terms of creating the spatial audio. Yeah, so that's if you like to create like a depth, so that you would like to feel the distance between one place and the another. So that's why we have this microphone on different places, and this is also taking into account in the calculations then for creating the ambisonics in one place. Yeah. So of course we take this into account, and this is very, very important parameter in the interpolation. Okay. Next question: at which distance did you calibrate the microphone? I fully understand. If we talk just for the single microphone, Zylia ZM-1, then we calibrate those microphones in anechoic chamber, and we have a dedicated hardware and software for that, and the distance between the loudspeaker and the microphone is 1.5 meters. But we also did test for like a different distances, and there is not let's say like a huge influence for like this distance and the perceived quality. But this is a really good question. I think maybe in the future we can also provide like a filters that you will have in the Ambisonics encoder that were measured in different distances from the microphone, the loudspeaker, if I correctly understand this question.
Okay, the next question is from Rodrigo. I think I can answer that. It's, could you please explain the advantages of a Zylia 6 of production system over more traditional multi-omnidirectional mics and audio object mixing, for example, besides spatial resolution? So the advantages are, for example, less processing power consumption, and because we're using only recorded audio, we're not doing any simulation. We've just recorded real acoustics of the place, and this is actually another advantage that the acoustics is captured really precise, and also it creates like a more immersive feeling, because it's so accurate. I don't know, Tomek, if you want to add something, maybe.
Yeah, so as Tomek mentioned, that if you use the omnidirectional microphones, then you don't have the directivity in this particular place. Of course, you can have a sense of the distance if you, let's say, jump from one omnidirectional microphone to another, but there is no directivity in that place. By directivity, I mean if you place the Ambisonics microphone in particular place, then you can decode it, for example, to this binaural audio, and you will hear the sounds from different directions, and you can clearly hear that the location of the sound. Yeah, and this is something that you don't have if you have omnidirectional microphone. And if you have more of those microphones, then you can Ambisonics microphones, then you can even have like a very high resolution spatial audio with the very high detail representation of the localization of the sounds around you. So that's the main difference, and also that we demonstrated during this presentation. So zero of order of Ambisonics. This is actually the first. This is the omnidirectional microphone, and then we go to the higher orders. And from the researchers, from the different studies and research, let's say that, like, the sweet spot between the perceived quality of the localization of the sound and the Ambisonics order. So the sweet spot is the third order Ambisonics. And that's why we also focus on this solution. That's why we also develop this third order Ambisonics. But this is like a other topic. Maybe next question. Is it possible to rent this setup for 6 days of recordings for testing? we usually don't do this, but maybe the short answer is why not, but it highly depends on the use case. Yeah, but let's stay in touch, and we can elaborate about this after this webinar. The next question is, I really don't understand dummy head.
I think this is connected with the HDRF question. Mm-hmm. About which HDRF were we using, right?
Yeah, okay, so I think that we already answered that question.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So the next was how accurate is mapping the location between the individual microphone on the software? I don't know, Mac.
Yeah, it depends on how accurate you'll make your measurements when doing a recording, because when we did, for example, the mentioned Philharmonic Orchestra recordings, we did measure it first we did place the microphones as we wanted, but then we had to measure it once more, because it was not so perfect. So we've measured every distance between each microphone, and then did a grid out of it, so we had actually pretty accurate positions up to maybe 1-2 centimeters, I think.
Yeah, and this is also something that you can set up in the software. The next question is, so 6DoF is only possible with the ZM-1S and ZM, not the ZM-1. Yeah, that's the correct answer. The ZM-1 is a third order Ambisonics microphone, but this microphone doesn't support for external synchronization. That's why we developed a new microphone which has very similar name, but it have this S at the end, and this microphone has changed electronics, and it support, and it has a support for time codes. And the other feature is that you can aggregate many of those microphones, Ambisonics microphones, together. So for example, you can take like a huge USB hub, for example, with 100 inputs connected to the computer, and connect all of these microphones with the USB interface, and you don't need anything anymore, audio interfaces, just the USB hub, and that's all. And this is not possible with the first model of microphone that we have, the ZM-1. The next question is, what is the typical distance between Zylia mix needed to represent a space accurately? Okay, very good question. We put this article on the chat where we did measurements and different setups of the microphones. Also, we compare it with, let's say, this omnidirectional approach, so you can check exact data. But I can answer this question that the distance that we tested and works really well with the local, with the perfect interpolation and localization is around four meters between each of the microphones, so that the grid can have like a four. The distance can be like 4 meters from each other, but in theory, this distance can be, let's say, up to 10 meters. This is, but then you can have like a grid of four microphones and the distance of 10 meters. Why 10? Because this is like the biggest distance that we can, for example, isolate, that we tested, and we can isolate the sound sources. So for example, if you put these microphones in some crowded space and choose the direction, and the person from the microphone is like 10 meters from you, so you can clearly hear that person. Yeah, so it means that the spatial resolution still works pretty well at that distance, and then you can create like a bigger grid for the 6DoF. I hope that I can correctly answer this question, but 4 meters, up to 4 meters, it should work pretty well. Of course, the lower the distance, then the higher is the spatial resolution, and the smaller is the error. Yeah. Could you provide more technical details about your beamforming modes? Okay. Okay, you can also find this on in our documentation and the white paper. So maybe I would like to ask our support team to put this on chat. So the modes works in this way, that S1, S2, that we create like beamformers. But maybe for people that maybe that not are our customers. This is not related to the 6 degrees of freedom technology. The other software that we have that can also be run on top of this microphone is a software for microphone virtualization, or let's say the beamforming that you can do. So you can mimic other sound of other microphones. So for example, if you record with Zylia, then you can create like beam patterns or with different shapes. And you can say that, for example, like to have a Shure-like sound, yeah, or some other microphone sound. So the modes. So then we have different options, and not going too much details. So we one of them is just we create the polar pattern, and the other mode it works in the way that it tries to remove some of the part of the sphere from the beam pattern. So more details is in the article. The medium and the high, this is something that it relates to the separation. So we have also like two modes. So medium is like a true beamforming, like a spatial filtering. And the high is like we also add like a blind sort separation. So there is like additional post-processing that removes the unwanted noises. So as I mentioned before, if you put this mic on the like a crowded space, there is a lot of people and you can just create like a very narrow beam to a person 10 meters away from you, and you can have like a clear voice, clear sound of that person. So that's how this mode works. Okay. The next question, would love to know more about third order being ambisonic sweet spot. Okay.
I'm not sure I understand this question.
Okay. Okay, maybe I'm not sure if I understand this question, but I will try. So in terms of the ambisonics and let's say something which is I will define the sweet spot. So the place where the hearing sound is like say the best one. So if you take the first order ambisonic, so the sweet spot is almost so there is no sweet spot. This is super small. It's like a point in the space, and so it means that you are not able to everything that you hear is very close to you. But if you go to the higher order of ambisonics, so you have a feeling that you have more and more space around you. You still the sweet spot is very very narrow, but you have an impression that the sounds is not sitting inside your head, but let's say they are outside and in the correct positions. So as I mentioned before, the third order of ambisonics, according to different research, is like a trade-off between the best trade-off between the perceived quality and the ambisonics order. Okay. Jean Torres, how are you? Are there going to be a future ZM-1 that will have synchronization in it? So the short answer is yes. So we're still working on the development of new hardware and software. And as probably some of you know, we trying really take care into take into account all the comments that we receive from our customers. So we have a lot of active beta testers, and we try to, you know, every feature that we add is based on the comments from our customers. So right now, the in terms of the synchronization, so the only microphone that we have is the ZM-1S, which is a new model, which is also a part of 6.0 system. But we are also working on new hardware. But if you asking me about the synchronization with other microphones, then it's possible, for example, on macOS, if you do the aggregated device. So maybe the next question, do you consider your microphone as a rigid sphere?
There's also a follow-up to this one. This is related to the way that you perform your distance equalization.
Mm-hmm. Yes and no. So we evaluation, the internal evaluation that we do, then of course this is the easiest way to take into account that this is a rigid sphere, but but we are not taking this into but the real product is measured in the anechoic chamber, and then we take into the account the real shape of this unit. So every unit is exactly the same. So as you maybe, if you are a customer, you may notice that the shape of this microphone, like the this microphones that we use, they are the small cavities. So this is everything was, let's say, tested during this development of those microphones in order to provide the best quality and the spatial resolution. And so answering this question, you can take into account, if you are a scientist, you can take into account that this microphone is a rigid sphere, and the, let's say, the error from the reality will be not very big, but that's why we provide our own Ambisonics converter and filters that take into account the real measurements of the real shape of this microphone. Okay, I get the notice that we should finish this Q&A session. Okay, so maybe thank you so much for all of the questions. I also see that there is also a couple of our customers, so it's great to see you, to have you here. And you know, if you have any additional comments, just send us a message on support@zylia.pl, and we'll try to answer all of them. So mainly behind this question is usually is Pedro, that is also here on the chat, but also the whole team is trying to respond as soon as possible. So if you have any additional questions, so please write to us, and if you also like to schedule like a call with us and know a little bit more about the system, so we are also open for any discussion, and it will be great to know what are you doing, how do you would you like to use this system, or how do you use the system right now, and how we can improve, or how can we help you with your work. Okay, Tomek. Okay.
Maybe one last thing. I want to also thank you for your time, interest, and engagement in this seminar. And I want to also invite you to our next seminar, part two, which will be about 6DoF multipoint higher order ambisonics recording of a music trio, which will happen on 25th of March, and it will be done by Florian Grond. And part of this recording was presented here on the seminar. It was the Esperanza by Christoph Papadimitriou. I wanted to invite you to this next webinar.
Okay, thank you so much, and see you next time.
Thank you. See you. Bye.